Colombia came into his own, dishing out a neat performance, scoring a prolific victory to claim the Maharaja of Mourvi Trophy. The Malesh Narredu ward quickly settled into third, Sugar Bay got past Mount Rushmore to lead the field all the way into the home stretch. Colombia made steady progress effortlessly and sailed into the lead past the 400 meter mark.
Efficient widest to fall, but Colombiana in the last 100 meters, three lengths ahead of Mount Rushmore. Colombiana in the colours of the Arion Racing Company Private Limited winning this one from Magnificence with the money.
With jockey Kamlesh having very little to do, the bay colt accelerated well and sealed the issue at least a furlong from home. Mount Rushmore was flat to the board while Magnificence arrived late from the rear to take the second spot. Bold Appeal failed to impress and would need to improve a lot more. Colombiana proved far superior to this bunch and looks ready for the Indian 2000 guineas.
Colombiana was running after a big gap, though he had a good form. He ran second to Costa and then he ran second in the Hyderabad Colts trial in the to Desert God. And on his way back, actually he ran second, close second to Hyderabad in with Desert God. It was thanks to Siraj the way he rode like a possessed Desert God that he won and I had to run second behind him. But anyway, when he's on his way back from Hyderabad to Pune, this horse, the float met with the accident in the night at 2 o'clock. And it was raining and I think the driver went to sleep and he banged it. The whole float had toppled up and down. And the whole chassis, both the wheels were not there, they all come out. And the horse was dangling up and down for I think 4 or 5 hours. Then we have to get up at 2 o'clock in the night, get an ambulance, get the doctors, get a crane to straighten the float first to get the horse out. And we didn't know whether the horse was alive inside. I got a call again, so we went over there. He said, no, he's looks to be moving, looks to be okay, he's bleeding, but we don't know. But he was stuck inside. Then we have to cut open the float in the night and remove him from there. He was injured on his feet. Luckily, there were no serious injuries, only a little bit cut marks on the face and the legs. And he was shattered, actually. He was quite shaken up with that bad experience. The float had gone toppled 2-3 times when it went over. So I 500 horse, what good will the state on that, so I don't know. Luckily he survived, it's a miracle to race today. I don't know how he survived. And he came back, had to give him enough time to build up his confidence. And then he came back and he was started showing a lot of, he always had a class, so I was always had a hope on him. And he was running actually very short price. I was hoping that, you know, that trauma, what he has gone through doesn't bother him, which I was very impressed the way he won this race. Mourvi, though they say the Mourvi is a jinx, and I have broken with Be Safe the Ruya. I hope I does in the 2000 guineas with Colombiana.
Pacey Shroff's Lord Jim had only one rival in rodeo, and he went about his business with ease. Lord Jim, with Parmar in the saddle, was up in front soon on start, and the order didn't really change all the way to the winning post. Lord Jim looked clearly in command as he shot away from rodeo once in the straight and galloped on to score by a widening margin. Rodeo, running over a trip that was much too short, never looked like he was going to win at any stage.
Past the 400 and Lord Jim now increasing the lead, about 2.5-3 lengths in front of Rodeo, hard at work with about 250 meters more to run. No upsets here. Lord Jim traveling very nicely, smooth action, going away about 3.5-4 lengths in front of Rodeo. 100 to go and it's Lord Jim without dropping sweat winning this quite comfortably.
Solange was an impressive winner, scoring her second win back-to-back after her fluent maiden victory in Pune. This time as well, she looked in control, and although the margin wasn't as wide as it was in Pune, she never really looked like she was in any trouble at all, getting off her Mumbai campaign on the right note. She improved gradually from the mid-bunch to be a prominent second behind the leader Grand Vitesse at the turn, and once she surged to take charge, the race was all but over. Majestic, the other fancied runner, was far too back from the action, and Pure Bliss was further behind, languishing in the rear.
Round the turn and into the street, Grand Vitesse comes in on first. Solange is the one galloping up on the outside, another 2.5 lengths behind the Speed of Sound, and there's Brown Dynamite. Frank Est is on the far side, even more wider. There is Majestic, but Grand Vitesse stubbornly ahead from Solange, now going ahead. Solange has gone to the front from Majestic, is the one warming in third spot. After that, there is Frank Est and Leo the Fierce Horse, but Solange is a length and a half in front of Grand Vitesse. Then there's Majestic, but Solange is going to make it. From Majestic, finishing second ahead of Grand Vitesse, then there's a Pure Bliss from nowhere.
Solange was ridden by jockey P.S. Chauhan. Majestic warmed up too late, indicating that he's one to watch out for over a longer trip. Confiance was the popular fancy after her awesome victory in Pune, and she obliged her followers, pulling off another one. Beyond Horizons built a longish lead with another conquest in second. Confiance was alongside Eduardo, with Sunny C a close last. Another conquest made a move early in the straight to go past the leader.
From another conquest is the one making a nice forward move in the center. Confiance is now beginning to make a forward move on the outside. After that is Eduardo, but is another conquest in the center is the leader. From Confiance is the one galloping on the outside, has gone for the whalebone. After that there is Eduardo, but Confiance on the near side from another conquest is Confiance. From another conquest is Confiance makes it from
Confiance, however, arrived with a steady run, and after a couple of cracks fought her way past another conquest to score a comfortable victory. Another conquest was a close second, with Eduardo in third. Sweeping star with Yash Naredu in the saddle shot past Essence of Love soon on settling down to lead the field and kept the momentum going right through. She galloped resolutely once in the straight and drew away in the final furlong to score an emphatic victory.
Into the straight, Sweeping Success has gone away about 2.5 lengths in front of Essence of Love. Then comes Avant-Garde inching closer on the outside. A length further back, there is a Trahan in the middle. On the outside, there is Shadow Facts, and his eyes towards the inside is with about 200 meters more to run. Sweeping Success still about 2.5 lengths in front of Trahan, making a forward move on the outside. Avant-Garde also with them, but going for the line now with 100 to go. And Sweeping Success about a length and a quarter in front of Avant-Garde. Sweeping Star about 2 lengths clear of Trahan. Avant-Garde finishing up second, Trahan is third. After that, there's Shadow Facts.
Favorite Avant-Garde was found wanting as she failed to quicken as desired and ended a faraway second. Trainer Malesh Narredu was very pleased with his performance.
Sweeping Star, actually, she's a good filly. I personally feel she's more about a staying horse. Always targeted her for Oaks, but because a 3-year-old and this year's filly slot, I see nothing is outstanding, so I said let me take a chance. And this filly is a very moody filly, you know, sometimes she doesn't jump out. So my only worry was if she doesn't jump out the mile, she won't be able to cover up that much ground, you see. Miles become too sharp. But this time she took a decent jump, not a very quick jump, but at least with the field. And I could not see any pacemaker going in front over there, and she managed to go in front. She won well. I'm keeping my fingers crossed for the guineas.
Seika pulled off a minor upset with a prolific run to beat two strongly fancied rivals with surprising ease. The favourite Chicksaw failed to put the pieces together, while Phenomenal Memory could not capitalise after leading them for most of the way.
With about 350 metres more to run, and it's Seika now who goes slightly ahead of Phenomenal Memory on the outside there, length and a half behind his Glorious Opinion and Jigsaw together, but with about 200 metres more to run, Seika is travelling well, about 3.5-4 lengths in front. Seika now with 100 to go is going away to a very, very easy victory. Seika pulls it off in style from Glorious Opinion, finishing up second.
Seika quickened nicely in the last 400 meters, and once he got past Phenomenal Memory, there was no catching him. Seika with Sandesh up was an eventual winner by a widening margin, and he certainly seems to be one who's relishing the Bombay track. Trainer Karthik Ganpati had an interesting anecdote to share on Seika's character.
Well, all through Pune, he showed a dislike for the Pune track with the kickback and the rain. He was not very comfortable with the turning track. And last Bombay, towards the end, he had won a 7-furlong maiden very comfortably. We were just hoping that he likes the Mahalakshmi track, and I'm very happy that he proved it beyond doubt he loves Mahalakshmi. He developed very high fever, and he didn't know what to do. He had completely gone mad. He broke tables, chairs, half my stable was broken apart. Then the doctors in the equine hospital, RWATC Equine Hospital, there were eight of them, all eight were there with me till 2:30 in the night. We stabilized him. The next day morning, he broke everything, ran away. And we found him incidentally near the Rajendra Singh Ji Institute. It's about 2.5 kilometers. He went through the traffic at around 10:30 in the morning, scared a lot of people. He had a broken jaw, he had cut himself all up. He was brought back, he was in surgery, then he was in probably isolation room, you can call it. We used to put him in a padded room for the first 3 weeks. And I must say, the vets in RWATC, the whole team, they went out of the way to save this horse. And I'm very confident in saying that if this horse was anywhere else in India, he would have been put down by now. He's here, he's racing, he's winning. Can't ask for anything more. I must tell you something, Mahinder. This horse, every single person in the racecourse stable area knows this horse, because they're very scared of him because of the incidents that happened in Pune. And when this horse wins, every single stable staff, my staff, everyone are ecstatic, and they're so happy when this horse wins. This is the Bombay horse, you know. It doesn't belong to one particular stable, it belongs to the whole racecourse. He's beaten the fourth place winner, runner in the Pune Derby. He's shown some promise today. Let's take it step by step. I hope he wins some big race somewhere. It will be the icing on the cake, fairy tale ending.
Providence, ironically, did not have the luck of the race, and Ageless suffered due to a lack of it. Ageless found a clear passage a tad too late, as she found herself stuck behind horses at a crucial stage. Providence stretched out nicely coming into the final furlong and zipped ahead past Ageless, who was desperate to find an opening. By the time Ageless broke free, Providence had stolen a march, with Ageless arriving all but too late to lose by only a whisker.
Ageless is up on the outside, but covering ground on the outside with about 100 meters both run. It's Providence from the fast finishing Ageless. It's Providence from Ageless. Providence from Ageless. Providence from Ageless. Providence and Ageless locked together. After that, there is a quick fire.
I was singularly lucky to win this race because Ageless had some real bad traffic problems, but I was lucky I got away and managed to get there. And she's done me very, very proud. She's a filly very badly conformed, but today she's won in first class. She's really done me very well. And she'll probably have one more race and then retire. She's done more than we could have asked for.
With the racing season in Mumbai well underway, Saturday and Thursday threw up some interesting results with a few classic contenders going through their paces. The average horse weighs about 500 kilos and on the track races at speeds of about 60 kilometers an hour. That, as you can imagine, puts a lot of force on where the horse meets the ground, the hoof. Dr. Dan at the Singapore Turf Club explains the various issues that could arise in the hoof of a racehorse.
The average horse weighs about 500 kg and on the track it races about 60 k's. And so that, as you can imagine, puts a lot of force on the where the horse meets the ground, and this is where the hoof comes in. The hoof is a very important part of the horse's body. It's the shock absorber and it's the major protection of the soft tissues inside. There's an outside layer which is the like your fingernail, and it's made out of hard keratin. That's the protection. That's the outer hoof wall. On the bottom you have the frog. The frog is a softer structure, like your fingertip. And that's responsible for the cushioning. So we have the wall, the sole, which is hard, like your fingernail, and then the soft structures there, the bulb and the frog, which gives the cushioning effect, the shock absorbers. Now, if we go inside the hoof, we see the pedal bone. It's the last bone of the horse's hoof. Very important bone called the pedal bone, or P3. And it's the structure of this bone in relation to the soft tissue structures outside and the hard tissue on the wall and sole that give rise to a lot of problems. The horse was basically in the wild, travels about 30k a day, wandering around eating very roughage and small amounts of food. And all this walking through the rocky terrain wears the hoof naturally. Now, in domestic horses, we've brought them inside, we leave them in a box for long periods of time, there's no motion, and they're on a very different sort of diet. And this leads to a lot of challenges, that if we don't look after the hoof properly, then we get a lot of problems. And once again, with the lameness, no hoof, no horse.
Which are some of the other problems that you come, which you come in contact with on a day-to-day basis?
With hooves, we have the number one thing is bruising. What happens, they might stand on a stone and just damage the soft tissue structure under the sole. They'll be sore for a few days and then they're fine. They're just treated with soaking and some anti-inflammatory. But the big problem we see in racehorses is balance. It's getting the shoe on to the hoof in a correct way
that mimics
so the hoof can do its job. So it can land, put the weight down, not transfer pain, and then it must take off again, which that's called breakover. So the horse can push off in a balanced hoof, so it's a non-painful and efficient action. And this is very important for performance horses. You want them to run really well so they can win. And without a well-balanced hoof, they're going to struggle.
As far as faridity is also concerned, and the shoe that the horse that are put on, the shoes that are put on the horses, you know, what distinguishes a good shoe or the perfect shoe from a bad job done?
A really good job is once again comes down to balance. So you must put the shoe on exactly the right spot. So you pick up and look at it. It's got to mimic the outer wall of the sole. It's got to have some spread, because even though it's a hard structure, it's still living. So every time it hits the ground, it expands and contracts. And that's important for hoof health and for blood flow. So you must allow some expansion, and you must pull the shoe back to the widest part of the frog. So a lot of horses, especially in Singapore, they stand in their boxes all day. They're not walking around eating like normal wild horses. They tend to sit back and the shoes slide forward. So then you get your low heel conformation, which is the number one unbalanced problem leading to poor performance we see here in Singapore.
What exactly is laminitis?
Laminitis is a failure of the support between the bone on the inside of the hoof and the structures around it. So basically, the bone there are three major causes. One is when the animal is sick, the toxins, they basically dissolve the attachment between the bone and between the hoof, and it just dissolves and the bone falls downwards with the weight of the horse. Another reason is if the horse is lame on one leg and holds one leg up, the other leg takes all the weight, and there's no blood supply. It's just standing on its sore leg. And just through sheer pressure, the limb that's taking all the weight, that will get laminitis. There's two stages. There's the early acute stage and the chronic stage. The early acute stage, the horse is very painful. You must give the horse anti-inflammatories and cold therapy and get all the weight back onto the frog and onto the heel. The chronic stage, as I'd like to show you, is we take x-rays and we look at the balance, the rotation, and we do some corrective training with the farriers.
Thanks for joining us on The Winning Post. See you in a week's time. Do follow me on Twitter at Mohit Lalvani, and you can connect with us on our Facebook page at www.facebook.com/winningpostracing, and watch this episode again on our YouTube channel. May the horse be with you. We'll be right back.